of radiotherapy in Ewing sarcoma. So Ewing sarcoma family of tumor are a group of small round cell tumor showing varying degrees of neuroectodermal differentiation. The Ewing sarcoma is the least differentiated among the Ewing sarcoma family of tumor. They are highly sensitive to chemotherapy and radiotherapy. Radiotherapy was applied for Ewing sarcoma almost from its first description. In fact, in words of James Ewing, when the diagnosis of endothelial myeloma is suspected, the writer believes that the first indication is for treating with radiation in full doses and over a considerable period. The response to radiation also confirms the diagnosis. So these were the words of James Ewing, after whom this tumor has been named. So I'll be mainly concentrating on the radiotherapy because I think you'll have separate classes for chemotherapy and surgery. So I'll be just discussing the role of radiotherapy in Ewing sarcoma. So management of Ewing sarcoma involves induction chemotherapy followed by local treatment in the form of surgery or radiotherapy. And this is followed by maintenance chemotherapy or adjuvant chemotherapy. So as far as the local therapy is concerned, whether surgery is better or radiotherapy, there is no head-to-head comparison. But there are many retrospective studies which suggest better control with surgery than radiation, of which I have just chosen some important studies which points that surgery is better than radiation as far as the local control in Ewing sarcoma is concerned. So this was collaborative Ewing sarcoma groups, cooperative Ewing sarcoma group study 86, in which it shows that local control with surgery was 100%, surgery plus radiotherapy 95%, and radical radiotherapy 86%. However, there's no improvement in relapse-free survival and overall survival because of the higher rate of metastasis after surgery. These are some of the studies which points toward improved local control with surgery. Among these, the IES 2 study, in which in the RT arm, the local control was 85%. In the surgery arm, the local control was 91%. And if radiotherapy is given after surgery, the local control was 100%. With 5-year survival in RT arm 59, surgery 73, and both 62. In cooperative Ewing sarcoma study group 86, in RT arm, the local control was 86%, in surgery arm 100%, combined surgery and radiotherapy 95%, with 5-year survival in the RT arm 70%, surgery arm 66%, and combined surgery and radiotherapy both was 74%. Here, the 5-year survival was less because it was seen that the distant metastasis was more with surgery. Then there was a pooled analysis where all these 81, 86, and 92 studies were compiled together, and this consisted of more than 1,000 patients between 1981 to 1999. And this study shows that local control was to the tune of 96% when surgery was done. With RT, it was 74%, and when radiotherapy was combined with surgery, the local control was 92%. The another study, which was international 0091, intergroup 0091 study, which was conducted between 1988 to 1992. In this study, the local failure rate with surgery and radiotherapy were similar. However, the local control was better when surgery was combined with radiotherapy. So all these studies point toward better control with surgery than radiotherapy. So coming to the indications for radiotherapy, so what are indications for definitive? Radio can be given in definitive setup, pre-operative or post-operative period.
Sir, it turned down, say, is the...
Pardon? Hello? Yeah. So radiotherapy can be given as definitive radiotherapy, pre-operative, post-operative or in palliative setup. So what are the indications for definitive radiotherapy? So tumors where resection is impossible, for skull, face, vertebra, or pelvic primary, where only an intralesional dissection is achievable because of the very large growth or it is involving the neurovascular bundle, etc. Patient who are poor surgical candidate or with comorbidities, or patients refusing surgery. So these are the indications for definitive radiotherapy. Preoperative radiotherapy is usually given when narrow resection margins are expected. So coming to indication of post-operative radiotherapy. So post-operative radiotherapy is given when there is a gross or microscopic positive margin, close margin, or poor histological response to new adjuvant chemotherapy, where there is more than 10% viable tumor cells in the specimen or less than 90% tumor necrosis. So these are main indications where post-operative radiotherapy is given. Palliative radiotherapy, in the form of whole lung irradiation where the multiple nodule in the lung, bone metastasis or spinal cord compression, or if there is evidence of bleeding or impending ulceration, etc., there we can consider giving palliative radiotherapy. What should be the radiotherapy time, dose, and fractionation schedule? So for definitive radiotherapy or gross residual disease, the standard treatment is total dose of 55.8 gray at 1.8 gray per fraction per day with a field reduction at 45 gray. Local control rate with this regimen is to the tune of 53% to 93%. For post-operative radiotherapy, a dose of 45 gray is usually 45 gray in 25 fraction is usually recommended. In COG study, a dose of 50.4 gray at 1.8 gray once a day was prescribed for post-operative radiotherapy. For pre-operative radiotherapy, a dose of 36 to 45 gray is usually given. Now coming to the radiation field, what should be the radiation portal when we are giving definitive radiotherapy? So historically, even sarcoma was treated with very large radiation treatment portal, encompassing the entire involved bone and marrow cavity. This was mainly because in Ewing sarcoma, we often come across skip lesion. But in the era of adjuvant chemotherapy, radiation treatment portals have become smaller with equivalent or improved local control. So the chemotherapy takes care of any skip metastasis or medullary disease, and we concentrate on the local disease. In POG 8346 study showed that traditional approach of irradiating the entire marrow cavity was not necessary. So this slide shows the initial radiation portal when we used to encompass the entire marrow cavity and the latest one. So the figure 1 shows the field encompassing the entire length of the medullary cavity for a tumor involving the proximal left humerus. And the figure B shows the tailored field encompassing only the proximal aspect of the leg for a limited tumor of the left tibia. Now, what should be the volume of the radiotherapy? So in radiotherapy is given phase 1 or phase 2. In phase 1, the dose is 45 gray in 25 fraction with 1.8 gray per day. And phase 2 consists of boost phase where the total dose is 10.8 gray into 6 fraction. So in phase 1, the gross tumor in the bone and soft tissue plus 2 cm longitudinal margin plus 2 cm radial margin should be included. In boost phase, we reduce the volume and reduce 1 to 2 cm margin with bone and residual tissue which include the bone and residual tissue. So this diagram shows the GTV1, that is pre-induction bone and pre-induction soft tissue extent, this one, and this diagram shows GTV2, which is post-induction soft tissue extent with the margin. So this area is treated in phase 2. So in present era, we are treating most many of the site with the conformal techniques. So this include the CTV, that is clinical target volume, GTV, and the PTV. So what should be the GTV in the current era when we are treating the patient with the conformal technique like IMRT, IGRT, etc.? So the CTV one includes the pre-chemotherapy GTV plus 1 centimeter with at least a 0.5 centimeter addition for the PTV one. The boost is to the residual tumor volume at the time of RT, that is GTV2. So in the boost phase, we include the residual tumor which is left after the chemotherapy. So boost is to the residual tumor volume at the time of RT plus 1 centimeter margin with or without a 0.5 centimeter margin for the PTV. For definitive radiotherapy, we treat PTV1 to a total dose of 45 gray followed by boost to 55.8 gray to the PTV2. In the pre-treatment, MRI scan is critical because any abnormal signals within the marrow cavity of the same bone, even if distant from that lesion, should be treated in the initial field as well as the GTV2. So whenever we are planning with conformal technique and in the era of when we are using the reduced field for the Ewing sarcoma, we should have a MRI of the bone involved so that if there is any disease in the marrow cavity, we can include. Now there are certain concerns when we plan for extremity lesion. Whenever we are treating the soft tissue sarcoma of the extremity, there is risk of lymphedema. So what should we do? So for extremity lesion, it requires sparing of at least 1 to 2 centimeter strip of tissue to prevent lymphedema. So whenever we are planning, we just leave 1 to 2 centimeter of the strip so that lymphatic drainage is not impaired. In arm lesion, doses of up to 20 to 30 gray can be given to the entire circumference if necessary without any sequelae followed by field reduction. However, leg is less tolerant and it may be necessary to consider surgery as an alternative if a strip of tissue cannot be spared. Whenever possible, the adjacent epiphyses and joints should also be spared by treating an extremity tumor, however, not at the cost of the tumor. Even partial treatment of uninvolved epiphyseal growth plate is avoided because if the epiphyseal growth plate receives more than 20 gray, this can lead to premature closure of the epiphysis and thus growth retardation. Now, coming to RT for the pelvic tumors. So whenever we are dealing with the pelvic tumor, the major concern is the radiation cystitis. So radiation cystitis can be a significant risk even at low dose, as low as 20 gray. This is because all these patients of Ewing sarcoma, they receive cyclophosphamide or ifosfamide, which itself causes some toxicity to bladder. So when we add radiation, that toxicity get enhanced and that is the main concern. So with the high doses of cyclophosphamide or ifosfamide given in chemotherapy regimen for Ewing tumor, it is important to minimize the dose to the bladder. Pelvic lesion rarely infiltrate into tissue around the bladder, but it pushes aside these structures. So in such cases, the new adjuvant chemotherapy allows the bladder to be spared by shrinkage of the tumor. So whenever we give new adjuvant chemotherapy, the tumor shrinks and this helps in reducing the dose to the bladder. The other precaution what we take while planning the radiation in the pelvis is that the radiation is planned in the filled bladder. So distension of the bladder. Distension of the bladder prior to each date treatment can reduce the amount of small bowel in the radiation field. Now, chest wall lesion. The rib lesion should be treated conformally with a minimum of lung and heart in the high dose field. Whenever we are treating the chest wall lesion, the concern is the underlying lung or the heart, which is nearby. So we have to plan. Most of the time we plan with the conformal technique and we don't go for 2D conventional technique for the chest wall lesion. When we're planning, sometimes when the lesion is involving the pleural cavity or there's pleural infiltration, initially there was pleural effusion at presentation, or there is a suspicion of intraoperative contamination of the pleural space. In such circumstances, hemithorax radiation can be given. So this should be considered for chest wall primaries with pleural involvement. RT is given to the hemithorax. Initially, we give RT to the hemithorax, entire hemithorax, 15 gray at the rate of 1.5 gray per fraction. And this is followed by RT to the primary to the total dose of 55.8 gray. So the dose to the hemithorax is limited to 15 to 20 gray only, and tumor boost is given separately. Now, while we are dealing with the vertebral lesion, the standard dose to the vertebral lesion is usually 45 gray, especially if spinal cord is in the treatment volume. Because the tolerance to the spinal cord is the major issue here. So we many a times we are not able to go beyond a dose of 45 gray. However, if it permits, we should go for higher dose, but most of the time it is not possible. Use of BD fractionation, that means twice daily fractionation, may allow some escalation of the dose to the spinal cord. Sacral lesion, which are large, should be treated to the full dose. Sacral lesion, we can treat to the full dose because in this area, the spinal cord ends and we are not concerned about the spinal cord tolerance, and we can escalate the dose to 55.8 gray. Now, while dealing with other sites, the definitive RT is also used for the skull, face, and other primaries and for unresected disease. Whenever it is not feasible to do complete surgery, definitive RT is the answer. Gonadal avoidance or additional shielding may be required in pelvic or other primaries. So whenever we are dealing with the pelvic lesion, we should, if it is a male patient, we have to shield the gonads. And if we are dealing with the female patient, then we may have to consider for ovarian transposition. Now, irradiation of the Achilles tendon is also avoided while dealing with the extremity tumor. So normally the dose which we prescribe, the standard dose for Ewing sarcoma is 55.8 in 31 fractions. So should we escalate the dose of radiation to radiation for the Ewing sarcoma? So this was a study by Dr. Lasker et al. From TMH, where they had done a randomized trial where they compared the standard dose RT or escalated dose RT. In standard dose RT, they gave the standard dose 55.8 gray in 31 fractions. In the escalated dose RT, after the standard dose, they gave a boost of to increase the dose up to 70 gray. So it was seen that in standard dose RT arm, the local control was 55.3, and the escalated dose RT arm, the local control was to the tune of 79.2%. However, there was not a significant difference between the event-free survival and the overall survival, but local control was definitely superior as compared to the escalated dose radiotherapy. The toxicity also was not significant in the escalated dose radiotherapy. So it is feasible to escalate the dose in the Ewing sarcoma without any additional toxicity, which translates into improved local control. Now coming to whole lung irradiation. So whole lung irradiation is usually given after the completion of chemotherapy or metastatic. So the usual doses what is prescribed for whole lung irradiation is 15 gray with 1.5 gray per fraction for patients less than 14 years, 18 gray for patients more than 14 years of age, 12 grade for children less than 6 years of age. So is there any literature for whole lung radiation? There's no prospective study as far. There's one study going on in US, but that's a multicentric study, but result is not yet there. There's one study from MSKCC where whole lung irradiation shows a freedom-free pulmonary relapse of 45% at 3 years. In fact, we are also conducting a prospective study where whole lung irradiation is given for pulmonary only metastatic disease. It's going on. So far we have just included 7 or 8 patients. So we will be able to answer after this trial. Now, if there are less than 4 metastases, then resection can be considered. However, if there are multiple metastases, then whole lung irradiation is the answer. If residual mets after whole lung RT, then focal boost to 45 gray can be given to the largest region, but this is usually associated with significant toxicity to the lung and severe decline in the pulmonary function. So normally it is not given. Now coming to the preoperative RT. So what are the indications for preoperative RT? The patient with a poor response to the chemotherapy, that is less than 50 reduction of the evaluable soft tissue mass after 2 cycles of chemotherapy. The another purpose of preoperative radiotherapy is to sterilize the tumor compartment before surgery and thereby potentially reduce the rate of dissemination during the surgery. And third is when we expect a narrow resection margin during the surgery. So these are the situations where we include preoperative radiotherapy in Ewing sarcoma. It does not lead to reduction in systemic failure, but it is good for local control. Local recurrence is less than 5% when preoperative radiotherapy is given. But there will be drawbacks of the preoperative radiotherapy, that this may increase the infection rate postoperatively and it may interfere with the bony union. Now, can post-operative radiotherapy be omitted in localized standard risk Ewing sarcoma? So this was an observational study by Euro Ewing group, and many a time we come across where there's a discussion that this RT should be given in chest wall or not. So this study showed that the benefit of post-operative radiotherapy was particularly marked for tumors larger than 200 ml at diagnosis and with 100% necrosis. So even if there is 100% necrosis, that is in standard risk Ewing sarcoma, if the tumor volume was more than 200 ml we should, and margins are negative, we should consider giving post-operative radiotherapy, because this was the group which was benefited maximally. So to summarize the doses and fractionation schedule for the Ewing sarcoma, so for the gross tumor, the initial field includes 36 to 45 gray with 1.8 gray per fraction, and the good field 10.8 gray to 18 gray with 1.8 gray per fraction per day.
You are audible, ma'am.
Okay. So is there any role of accelerated hyperfractionation in Ewing sarcoma? So twice a day radiation has been used in several trials. The expected advantages are limited field size, minimized long-term complication, and it provides superior functional outcomes. This slide I wanted to build later, sorry. So this was a study which was published in Red Journal, which deals with the local control and functional results after twice daily radiotherapy for Ewing sarcoma of the extremity, where they used 1.2 gray twice daily to a dose of 50.4 gray, 55.2 gray or 60 gray, depending on the tumor response to induction chemotherapy. And it showed late effects could be decreased while maintaining the good local control. So with twice daily hyperfractionation, the late effect can be decreased. Now this was another study where radiation therapy in Ewing sarcoma was, this was an updated analysis of CES 86 study. There they showed that there was no advantage for the accelerated hyperfractionated approach. So still the standard of care is single daily fractionation only. Accelerated hyperfractionation may reduce the late toxicity, but it does not show any advantage. Now coming to the proton therapy. So proton therapy has an advantage of delivering very localized dose to the tumor and sparing the adjacent critical structures. This is especially important in the areas like skull, where the tumor is closer to the optic chiasm, to the brainstem, tumor closer to the spinal cord, where we are not able to give significant dose due to the dose OR constraints. So in these areas, we can spare the critical structures and escalate the dose to the tumor. If we compare the dose color wash for the IMRT and for the proton therapy, we can see that in IMRT, there is significant dose to the adjacent lung, to the spinal cord, and to the other adjacent structure, whereas this is the dose color wash of the proton, which is highly conformal. Again, this was the dose color wash for the IMRT, and this is the dose color wash for the IMPT, that is intensity modulated proton therapy, where we can see that dose to the adjacent structures are less as compared to the IMRT plan. So this way we will be able to escalate the dose to the tumor and limiting the dose to the critical structures, and this may result in the better local control and overall survival. So why this happens? If we see the curve for the what happens in proton therapy, they have a Bragg peak. So the dose delivered to the organ is where the tumor is, there's very sharp peak, and at this point the dose delivery is maximum, where the adjacent critical structures receive less dose. So what is the risk of second malignancy in patients who are treated for Ewing sarcoma? This is also a concern because most of the patients of Ewing sarcoma are below the 20 years of age. So this was a systematic review where they saw that cumulative incidence of secondary malignancy ranged from 0.9 to 8.4% at 5 years and 10.1 to 20.5% at 30 years after initial diagnosis. Thank you. Anyone has any question? So I'm willing to take questions.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a very nice lecture. There are some questions in the chat box.
Okay, I'll take.
Could I read out, ma'am?
Yes, just one second. I'm just trying to join. I'll stop sharing. Okay, so please enter with right name. What do you consider as close margin? Okay. So, the first question is, what is the close margin? So this we always have a debate, because most of the patient who come to us in sarcoma, they would have received induction chemotherapy. And usually the surgeons, they say that if it is closer to the cartilage, then even 1 mm margin is also equivalent to 1 cm. So normally what we say, if margin is more than 0.5 mm, we take it as close margin. Less than 0.5 mm, we take it as close margin. And there the patient should have RT, the normal indication, less than 0.5 cm. The second question was, what is the rationale for RT to hemithorax? So the RT to hemithorax was given in patient where there was initially, they had involved, the tumor was involving the pleura, or there was pleural effusion at presentation, or there was risk of contamination of pleural cavity while the surgery was done. This was to reduce the chances of local recurrence. So this was a study which was I had shown in the slide. I'll just go back to the slide and show. So this one slide which I did for the hemithorax irradiation. So as I said, for post-op cases, it is indicated whether initial pleural effusion, the or there was suspicion of pleural infiltration upfront or intraoperative contamination of the pleural space. This was based on the European Collaborative Ewing Sarcoma Group study 92 trial, where the 7-year event-free survival was 63% versus 46% when the RT was given. The RT dose in this was 15 gray at 1.5 gray per fraction.
Ma'am, the slide is not visible.
Acha. Sorry. I'll just show you the slide. Then I need to share it. I'll share it. So this was a slide which I showed where RT is given to the hemithorax. So initially 15 gray at 1.5 gray is given to the entire thorax, entire hemithorax, and this is followed by boost to the tumor to a total dose of 55.8 gray. And this is usually given in the case where there was initial pleural effusion, there's pleural infiltration or intraoperative contamination of pleural space, and this is based on the study EICA's 92 trial, where 7-year event-free survival was 63% versus 46% with hemithorax irradiation. However, normally nobody gives, because most of the patient nowadays, these trials were in early 90s, where chemotherapy were not that much practiced. But nowadays, patients receive chemotherapy, and we unless there is a very high risk of contamination of the pleural space during surgery, we don't go for hemithorax readmission. Any other question?
Ma'am, there are questions. Please elaborate on the lung bath indications.
Prophylactic lung radiation and
yes, ma'am. And other questions are that if pre-op RT is given, do we give post-op RT also? Like if margin is positive or if any other indication is present, and when do we use brachytherapy in a case of Ewing sarcoma? And also regarding the hemithorax, the
what question. Is the rationale for RT? This I answered. What is the if there is a post-op RT? If we are giving post-RT, definitive RT, whether it is RT alone or giving chemo concurrently with RT, like Womert protocol. For which tumor? This is for. Rational for RT to hemithorax. Okay, so where do we give lung bath? So most of the time we are giving lung bath when there are multiple lung mets which cannot be taken care of, like up to 4 lesions should be surgically excised. But if there are more than 4 lesions and the local disease is controlled, then we can go for lung bath. Number one, prophylactic lung radiations, normally we are not giving because so far whatever lung radiation is given, it's given in the metastatic setup only. For even for the metastatic setup, whole lung radiation, there's no randomized trial, there's no prospective data also. These are all based on the retrospective study only. Like one I quoted that it is a study from MSKCC where Dana et al, they had used a whole lung radiation, and this was a this study includes patients from 1990 to 2014, and in that they show that freedom from pulmonary relapse was 45% at 3 years. There is one prospective trial, which is a multi-center trial, which is going on in US, involves 5 centers in US of the whole lung radiation, but it's still, the result is still awaited. So based on these studies where that shows that pulmonary relapse free interval at 3 years about 45%, several other retrospective studies have suggested this. So whole lung radiation is practiced. Prospective data is lacking for this.
So is whole lung radiation only done in case of Ewing's, or is there evidence for any other cancer also where we can use this?
This is used in other cancer also, like Wilms tumor, in rhabdomyosarcoma, in soft tissue sarcoma also a trial is going on in US. So people have used retrospectively in some case reports are there, where even in osteosarcoma it has been used. But the benefit is maximally seen in Ewing sarcoma, Wilms and rhabdomyosarcoma. Soft tissue sarcoma, we don't have robust data to say that it is beneficial. There is a prospective study going on. So we have to wait for the result.
Okay.
What else is there? Will the hemithorax dose of 10 gray be sufficient? So hemithorax dose, what we are giving is actually we divide into adult and pediatric group. So in adult patient, we go for Ewing sarcomas are very radiosensitive tumor. That's the reason for whole lung radiation also, the dose of 15 gray in 10 fraction or 18 gray in 10 fraction is sufficient. So it is divided into 3 groups. For children less than 14 years, children less than 12 years, usually this dose is limited to 12 gray only, because these children are growing children and they will have a very long term sequelae. So for children less than 12 years, the dose is less than 12 gray. 12 to 14 year of age or 16 year of age, the dose is around 15 gray into 10 fractions. And for an adult, that is anyone above 18 year of age, the dose is usually 18 gray in 10 fractions. And this shows quite good response because even being very radio sensitive tumors. If we are giving post radiotherapy, definitive radiotherapy, whether it's RT alone or giving chemo concurrently. Achha. So we are practicing concurrent chemo radiotherapy also. It's not like whenever we are giving post-op RT or definitive RT, we are practicing concurrent chemo radiotherapy as well. For Ewing sarcoma, after 12 weeks of back IE, if we are starting RT, we have to continue chemo along with that or RT alone. We are using concurrent chemo radiotherapy. Even during radiotherapy, the patients are receiving chemotherapy. Whether to use pre-chemo GTV or post-chemo GTV in RT planning. So as I dealt that in phase one, we include the pre-chemo GTV so that we take care of the margin. However, in the second phase, that is in the boost phase, we include the post-chemo GTV. So 45 gray in 25 fraction is given to the pre-chemo GTV. However, in the second phase where we are giving the boost 10.8 gray in 6 fraction, in that phase we include the post chemo GTV in RT planning. Any other question? Achha. If margin positive or any other indications, and when do we use brachytherapy? So normally, like in soft tissue sarcoma, apart from Ewing sarcoma, we are using brachytherapy. But in Ewing sarcoma, we are mostly not going for brachytherapy. Ewing sarcoma, mostly we are going for external beam radiotherapy only. Whereas in other soft tissue sarcoma, who are not very radio sensitive, we go for brachytherapy when the tumor is less than 10 centimeters in size. Definitive brachytherapy. If the tumor is more than 10 centimeters, then there also we go first for external beam radiotherapy and then we give boost to the tumor so that boost with brachytherapy so that we don't get any marginal recurrence or anything. Ewings are different from any other soft tissue sarcoma. They are very radio sensitive, and that is the reason they we give whole lung radiation in Ewing sarcoma as well. One centimeter strip of skin. Okay, so when we are planning radiotherapy for any soft tissue sarcoma of the extremity, like in the leg or in the arm, the main concern is the lymphatic drainage. So this 1 centimeter strip or 2 centimeter strip is given for the lymphatic channels to drain. Otherwise, what happens post radiation, there is fibrosis in that area and the lymphatic drainage is hampered. In upper limb, it can be managed because upper limb we can elevate and all the time it is not in the dependent position. Whereas in the lower limb, it is a weight-bearing area and it is always in dependent position. So it is essential to leave a strip of skin so that lymphatic drainage from the lower part is intact. Otherwise, the patient will have severe lymphedema post-radiotherapy. So that is the reason for giving 1 centimeter strip of skin. This is important when we are planning with the Hoodie techniques. While when we are planning with the conformal technique, when we are just giving margin around the tumor, then most of the time skin is already spared and the lymphatic drainage is intact. It can be preserved with that. The next question is whether to give RT or not when there is CR. So this also ideas that whether RT is beneficial in case where there is a 100% necrosis, or in standard risk even sarcoma when the margin is negative, because there is 100% necrosis. So this was another, this was studied by Euro Evings, where they showed that when the tumor volume is more than 200 ml and 100% necrosis, this was the group which benefited maximum by post-operative radiotherapy. So yes, when there is a large tumor and initial tumor volume was more than 200 ml, then even with CR, RT should be offered. Will 45 gray be sufficient in spinal cord tumor? Actually, ideally speaking, the dose should be more than 45 gray. But in the spinal tumor, with the IMRT, if the tumor is very close to the spinal cord, we are not able to go beyond 45 gray. So even being radiosensitive tumor, they do respond. If we are able to give even boost even to the tumor, in a such a way that spinal cord can be spared, then it should be given. In fact, in proton therapy, what happens, we can escalate the dose. There's a study from Florida where with proton therapy, they were able to escalate the dose to the tumor in these areas, like in closer to the spinal cord or closer to the chiasm or brainstem, and that resulted in a local control and overall survival to the tune of 96% to 92% at 4 years. So whenever it is feasible to give dose beyond 45 day, we should go for it, but many a times it is not possible. That's the reason we are not able to go beyond 45 day. If it is feasible, you are spared, you are able to spare the spinal cord, we must go beyond that. Most of the time we are able to go up to 50.4 gray, but beyond that it becomes difficult because of the close proximity to the spinal cord. Anyone else? Any other question which I have missed?
I think all of the questions are covered wonderfully. And if there is any other question, please, you can unmute yourself or put in the chat box.
Okay.
So what is the protocol you are using now? You talked about a trial going on at your place.
So this is actually done under a thesis protocol, which is a prospective study, where we are giving whole lung radiation. We have divided into two groups. So age less than 16 years and age more than 16 years. So in the patient less than 16 years, we are using 15 gray in 10 fractions. And in the patient more than 16 years, we are giving 18 gray in 10 fractions. So far we have included only 7 to 8 patients, which have shown very good response, but not in a condition to answer that what will be the final result. Probably by next year, this thesis will complete and I'll be able to answer. We intend to include around 20 to 30 patients in this study, and then we will be able to answer.
Okay. So ma'am, do we give lung irradiation only when the primary responds to the chemotherapy or radiotherapy? And is there any contraindication for it?
Ideally, the primary should be controlled, you know. Otherwise, there is no point in giving radiation for the metastatic disease. However, if it is symptomatic, like in trial, so we are taking the patient who has local control, local disease controlled. But otherwise, if it is causing symptom to the patient, like recently I'm having two patients. One responded wonderfully. He had very large tumor, almost occupying the, in fact, one of the metastases was involving almost half of the hemithorax on one side. And apart from that, there were many small mets. So this patient with 18 gray in 10 fractions had partial response, which was a very good things to ten, and very good quality of life after that. There's another child who is undergoing, she has almost the entire hemithorax filled with tumor. So But these patients will not have that effect which we intend to do with very large tumor. Small tumor will have better response. There is a trial which I quoted there also the tumors were not so huge. Probably in India only we see such huge tumors.
Okay, ma'am. So I think there are no more questions. And it was a wonderful lecture, ma'am. And we all enjoyed it. And we are really thankful to you that you gave your precious time.
I had a very hectic day. It's every